This paper explains the amount of selfish motives of people when it comes to splitting the bill after having dinner with friends. With the rise of behavioral economics and consumer behavior, economists wonder if people take costs on other people into account when making economic decisions. Several different experimental studies found that people free ride when it comes to consumption, but according to Dawes and Thaler, not to the extent that economic theory predicts. Therefore, despite the strong predictions described by the classical theory in externality settings, scientists nowadays have their doubts about it. Earlier studies did research about the selfishness hypothesis by using the standard public goods experiment. During this game, participants are asked to put private tokens into a public pot. After this, the total amount of tokens are multiplied by a factor, greater than 1, but less than the amount of participants. Thereafter, the total amount of tokens is equally divided among all the participants. But each participant also keeps the tokens they did not contribute. These experiments in which non-contribution is a dominant strategy typically find that participants are sensitive to free-riding incentives, but nonetheless cooperate at a level that the mainstream economic theory can't explain. However, as the game continues over and over, the contributions decrease every time. In all these studies, participants contribute less and less the longer they play. In other words, it seems that participants may be contributing in part due to inexperience or confusion under lab conditions. Andreoni raised criticism about these experiments, which he called collectively confusion. In order to explore this confusion, he designed a zero-sum version of the earlier mentioned public goods experiment. During this experiment, the sets of strategies and corresponding token payoffs were the same as the public goods experiment. But the payoff in tokens for one participant is balanced out with the payoff for another participant. Hence, one participant's gain is equivalent to another's loss. Andreoni concluded that the cooperation dropped significantly, but not entirely. On average, 75% of the participants are cooperative, and about half of these are confused about incentives, while the other half understood free riding but chose to cooperate out of some form of kindness.
Divided by 6, and everyone owes $28.
Okay. Everyone?
Oh, you're right, I'm sorry.
Thank you.
It's Monica's big night, she shouldn't pay.
Oh, thank you.
So 5 of us is $33.50 apiece.
No, no way. Sorry, not gonna happen.
Whoa, prom night flashback.
To test economic predictions, we investigate a familiar environment. The unscrupulous diner's dilemma is a well-known phenomenon in social environments. This dilemma describes that when a group of people go out for dinner together, there's most of the time an unspoken agreement to split the bill equally, like you saw in the scene of the series Friends. This means that a person can have a selfish dinner for a very low price. A naive approach would indicate that this is not a serious problem, but it seems that sometimes even best friends don't approve this method. Standard economic assumptions indicate that consumers are most satisfied when the marginal benefits outmatch the marginal costs and as a result increase their consumption. The opposite applies to low consumption. Therefore, at the utility maximizing consumption level, marginal cost must equal marginal benefit. Besides that, there is an assumption that the marginal utility is decreasing, otherwise consumers will consume infinitely. Thus, looking at these assumptions, the prediction according to the economic theory is that there is a negative relation between marginal costs and consumption. Several hypotheses emerge from the theory of selfish utility-maximizing consumers. Since marginal benefit must equal marginal cost, it will take greater and greater consumption to equalize marginal benefit to marginal cost, as removed from individual pay to even split and from even split to free meal. The following three main hypotheses emerge after the theory. Hypothesis 1, diners will eat more in the even split treatment relative to the individual pay treatment. Hypothesis 2, diners will eat more in the free meal treatment relative to the even split treatment. Hypothesis 3, diners will eat more in the free meal treatment relative to the individual pay treatment. An additional hypothesis emerged during the results. We will continue with design and method. A restaurant setting experiment was used to test the hypotheses. In the restaurant setting, multiple groups of 6 diners were manipulated and observed. The experiment counted 60 participants divided into 10 groups of 6 diners. All groups of diners consisted of 3 male and 3 female participants. As just mentioned, a restaurant setting was manipulated and observed. In the experiment, 3 different treatments were tested, with the only difference being the payment mechanism. So the 3 main treatments were all based on a different payment mechanism, which we will explain to you now. In treatment 1, the individual payment treatment subjects were told that they would pay for their own meal. In treatment 2, the even split treatment subjects were told that the bill would be evenly split between the 6 of them. In the 3rd treatment, the free meal treatment subjects were told that the meal would be fully paid by the experimenter. There were 4 groups of diners of the 1st and 2nd treatment. There were 2 groups of diners in the 3rd treatment. Half of the groups of the 1st and the 2nd treatment were asked how they preferred to pay, prior to hearing the payment mechanism. On to the results and findings. Figure 1 presents the results of the field study. The x-axis lists the 3 treatments, the y-axis shows the cost of the meals. As can be seen, the meal costs in the individual pay situation are lowest, somewhat higher in the even split treatment, and peaking in the free meal situation. Between the least expensive subject and the most expensive subject, there was an enormous gap. However, there was still a fairly small overlap in all meal costs. Using the parametric t-test and the non-parametric Mann-Whitney u-test, the study found that the samples under all 3 hypotheses were significantly different. Thus, it can be concluded that the costs in the individual pay treatment were substantially lower compared to the even split and the free meal treatments. So, individuals tend to eat for a higher price when they do not have to pay for all of it themselves. Likewise, costs of the meals in the even split treatment were lower than in the free meal situation. Figure 2 shows this distribution. These findings are consistent with the theory of selfish utility maximizing consumers. As the question arises whether the individual ignores all costs she imposes on others, or that she accounts for some, another link with the literature was made. The selfish agent assumption would imply that there should be no difference between splitting the bill among 6 people at the table compared to a situation where one only has to pay 1/6 of its individual consumption, indicating that they do not think about the cost they impose on others. Contrary to this, theories of altruism, equity and reciprocity would suggest individuals consume more in the case they would pay 1/6 relative to the even split treatment. A 4th hypothesis was formed, stating that diners will exhibit the same levels of consumption in the even split treatment and the pay 1/6 treatment. Also, this hypothesis was supported. This is in line with the selfish agent assumption. However, a remark must be made here, as the lack of significant difference could be due to the smaller sample size in the pay 1/6 treatment. While studies have shown differences in propensity for others and generosity between females and males, it would be expected that women would use the ability to impose costs on others to a lesser extent than men would.
Second date we went on, it was Wingstop. Okay. the bill came to $22.03. Okay. He looks at me and says, "You just give me $10.
The second argument for gender differences include physical limitations, and the third argument, discriminatory cultural norms related to eating. All 3 arguments would signify women to consume less than men. In the field study, however, no significant differences could be found between the genders in 3 out of 4 treatments. Only in the free meal situation, men tend to eat more. So for the field study, the first 3 hypotheses were supported with significant differences, while the 4th hypothesis was supported but had a lack of significance. Next to the field study in a restaurant, they extended the research to a lab setting. This is clearly a different setting, less familiar than in the restaurant. Upon that, it also yielded different results. Specifically, the difference between the individual pay and even split treatment, as in hypothesis 1, was not significant. In contrast, the difference between the even split and the 1/6 pay treatments, as in hypothesis 4, was highly significant. Thus, the experimental literature can be easily replicated in a restaurant setting, but not in a lab experiment. Lastly, the discussion, including limitations of the study and implications for understanding consumer behavior in general. With the enormous variety in meal cost, it could hardly be assumed to satisfy normality assumptions required by the t-test. Nonetheless, the test was used to report significance values. Secondly, the individuals in experiments did not know each other beforehand, while in practice, you enjoy a meal with friends or family. Also, the behavior in the experiments could be different from a real setting due to the lack of social interaction they were instructed to have. The limitations of especially the lab study were considerable. As Kim and Walker and Andreoni in the literature already noted, misunderstanding of the unfamiliar task could result in cooperation, as well as confusion and lack of experience with the task would. Finally, a limitation was the small sample size of the 1-6-pay treatment, not yielding a significant difference. In the study, 80% of the individuals indicated that they preferred to pay individually. However, what we see in practice is that groups tend to split the bill among each other. This has implications for consumer behavior more generally, as can be argued that people do not always make rational decisions, and individuals do not always behave as rational as being thought they would. Finally, we end with the conclusion. The study worked with the prediction that an economic agent who is able to impose some of the cost of his consumption on others will overconsume relative to the socially efficient level. This prediction was tested using the inscrupulous diner's dilemma in an environment close to real-life experiences. The study found that if theoretical predictions work, people react to changes in incentives and they largely seem to ignore negative externalities. These results have great importance in the design of institutions. Institutions and rules that ignore the effect of negative externalities are inefficient, not only in theory, but also in practice. While in the experiments, diners were having meals with strangers, it is more likely that in practice one would go to a restaurant with friends or family. This difference is critical, since with friends or family, the game is repeated, so punishment strategies in response to excessive waste are feasible. Some cost is involved in paying individually. A part of it could be the mental cost of figuring out one's share of the bill and calculating the portion of the tax and tip that apply to that share. Another part would be the social cost of appearing stingy or unfriendly. Given the cost of individually paying and the ability to reduce the inefficiency of splitting the bill for repeated game strategies, it may in fact be individually and socially optimal to split the bill among friends. However, the danger in customs which are based on rational decision-making is that once they become conventions, they are resistant to change, even when circumstances change. Consequently, it may be rude in some settings to suggest paying individually. One thing is for sure, the study gives us food for thought.